Tonight we're talking about innovation, and to be a little innovative, I thought I would start with a list of the top five accidental inventions in history. Top five, at least my top five. So here's my countdown. Number five is anesthesia. And the story goes like this. Back in 1844, there were a couple guys messing around with nitrous oxide. Now, your engineers, what is nitrous oxide?
Laughing gas.
Laughing gas, yes. They were enjoying, shall we say, the recreational use of it. Until a guy fell down, gashed his leg wide open, but oddly enough, he didn't even feel it. And voila, the earliest form of anesthesia was discovered. Number four is the popsicle. And this one was discovered, invented accidentally by an 11-year-old boy. Back in the early 20th century, kids used to make homemade soda pop by mixing powder and water. And this kid did that, but he left his concoction outside overnight. It was cold. It froze with the stirrer in. And so the next morning he goes out there, pulls the thing out of the cup, and what do you know? Frozen lollipop. What he'd later call a popsicle when he turned it into a lucrative business. Number three, which no doubt will be number one for many of you. This is the accidental invention of the chocolate chip cookie. A woman owned what was called the Toll House Inn in Massachusetts, and she was renowned for making chocolate cookies. That was one of her signature items, but at one point she ran out of the baker's chocolate powder used to make those cookies, so she was looking for a substitute. She found a bunch of Nestle's chocolate bars, broke those up, threw them into the batter, mixed it up, but it did not make chocolate cookies. All it did was make cookies with melted chocolate pieces in them. So when she reluctantly served them up to her guests, they were a huge hit and drove lots of business to her Toll House Inn and to Nestle's. And of course today we have what? Nestle's Toll House cookies. That's the origin of that. If you remember nothing else from tonight, maybe you'll remember that. I don't know. Number two on my list, Ben & Jerry's flavorful super premium ice cream. You see, we have a little bit of a dessert theme going on here tonight. And this one's a little bit wacky, sort of like the founders of this ice cream company. Back when Ben Cohen and Jerry Greenfield were experimenting with how to make ice cream, Jerry would make it and Ben would taste it. It was a great partnership that way. And if you ever saw Ben Cohen, you'd know that he was the taster. Anyway, Ben kept saying, "Jerry, put more flavor in, put more flavor in," which he did. And Ben would taste it, and eventually they hit on something they thought would work. The issue there, though, was that Ben has nasal problems. He can't taste very well. And so the resulting product was a much more flavor-packed ice cream than most people were accustomed to. And certainly a more profitable product than either of these unemployed 60s radicals would have created otherwise. You ever hear any of these stories? Some of them are pretty amusing. So what's the number one accidental invention of all time? In my opinion, it's the potato chip. And not only is this an accidental invention, it's also a retaliatory invention. This happened back in 1853. There was a restaurant patron who kept sending his French fries back to the kitchen, asking that they be made crispier. And he did it two times, three times, four times. Eventually, the chef got a little annoyed. He lost his temper. He said, "I'm going to teach this guy a lesson." He cuts the potatoes razor thin and cooks them up till they're just about burnt, loads them up with salt, and sends them back out to the dining room. But to his surprise, the customer absolutely loved them. And hence, we had the invention of the potato chip. All of these were accidental inventions. And there were a lot of honorable mentions as well. You can look up some of these. Coca-Cola, never intended to be a beverage, at least originally. Ice cream cones was an accident. Velcro, a dog actually helped invent that one. Viagra, interesting story there, but we'll keep this PG for today at least. Silly Putty, the Slinky. Play-Doh was originally a failed cleaning product. The microwave, couple of guys messing around with a radar-related project when the chocolate bar in one of their pockets melted. And so I guess they grabbed some popcorn kernels and, you know, the rest is history. Even our collaboratory here was never, at least originally, intended to be some organization or some center. Just a couple of smart, dedicated professors, Professors Vader and Pratt, working on some contributory research with some students, and a few years later, some of the more entrepreneurial students got them thinking bigger, and it's blossomed into this. Accidental inventions, or sometimes fortuitous inventions. Typically, though, innovation is far more deliberate than this. You can think of, perhaps, Henry Ford and the Model T automobile. You can think of Thomas Edison and the light bulb. You can think of the Wright brothers and their airplane. You can think of Milton Hershey and the affordable chocolate bar. You can think of Steve Jobs and, you know, just about everything else that we do today. But of course, innovation and innovators are not always household names. I just read a story about two women in Sweden. Their names are Anna Haupt and Therese Alston, who over the past 7 years have invented what they call the invisible bike helmet. You heard about these? Getting some knowing nods here. It's like this U-shaped thing that goes around, almost like one of those U-shaped pillows that goes around your neck, and you ride your bike with this on. But when you start to fall off your bike, the thing deploys much like an airbag around your head. It is ridiculously ingenious. You should look this up, the invisible bike helmet. Not right now, but at some point it would be worthwhile. That's much more typical of great innovation. It's often a deliberate and painstaking process that requires an almost obsessive focus for weeks, months, even years. Edison famously said that he didn't fail 1,000 times. He just found 1,000 ways not to make a light bulb. Right? You've heard that before. And it's this sort of fixation on getting it right that's the key to the competitive advantage of the world's most creative companies. Whether it's Google or Apple or Pixar Animation Studios or Procter & Gamble, even nonprofits like Saddleback Community Church. Familiar with that? That place out in California, Rick Warren's church? He's the purpose-driven life guy. Warren said that his church has failed at more things than most churches have ever tried. And he wears it as a badge of honor. We failed at more things than most churches have ever tried. That's what breakthrough innovation looks like. You try stuff, you take risks, you fail, you start over again, you learn from it, you move on, and you don't stop until you get it right. Sherwood Baptist Church down in Georgia, much the same way. Maybe some of you are familiar with that organization. They discern that people in our culture are much more influenced by movies than they are by the church. And so they decided that, among other things, they were going to make movies. And good movies. They made really good movies with wholesome themes. Maybe you're familiar with Facing the Giants, Courageous, Fireproof. You grew up on some of this, right? And they have been able to reach hundreds of thousands, maybe even millions of people that they would not have reached otherwise but for that risk-taking and but for that innovation. Please, don't miss the point here. The key to success that transcends almost all great innovators and innovations is not just a cool new idea. That just gets you in the door. That's just the price of admission. The other key to success is usually a single-minded determination to bring their cool new idea to fruition, regardless of the obstacles. They don't let these many formidable obstacles stand in their way. For example, they don't let resource constraints stand in their way. Whenever you're going to build something, usually you need some money for that, whether it's to build a prototype or to hire a staff or to pay your living expenses while you're doing this. But successful innovators pitch their idea indefatigably, passionately, almost evangelistically, until they get the resources that they need. Howard Schultz, familiar with that name? Back in the 1980s, this guy named Howard Schultz did not have a dime to his name. But he wanted to raise $3.8 million to buy this little coffee bean company in Seattle called Starbucks. And he wanted to turn it into an Italian-style coffee bar. Now recognize, in the 1980s, coffee was 50 cents a cup, and it was served in styrofoam. Schultz's idea was, I'm going to serve this in nicer cups, and I'm going to serve it for 5 or 6 times that price, and I'm going to give it Italian-sounding names that nobody can pronounce. Who's going to invest in something like that? A lot of people said no, but enough people said yes because Howard Schultz would not take no for an answer. And he raised his money, and we know the rest of the story. In fact, many of us are part of the rest of the story. Great innovators don't let resource constraints stand in their way. They also don't let the myopic people around them stand in their way. They don't let a toxic corporate culture of we've always done it this way, undermine them. They know that that's just plain stupid, and they will not have it. I heard a story of a guy who was watching his wife prepare a roast, and she cut the ends off the roast before she put it in the oven. So he asked her, why do you do that? You always do that. Why do you do that? And she said, well, it's because my mother always did it that way. And so he calls up his wife's mother and says, why is it that you cut the ends off the roast before you cook it? And what do you think her answer was? Because my mother always did it that way. So he makes one more phone call to his wife's grandmother, and he asks her the same question. And the old woman chuckled, and she said, well, I don't know why my daughter and my granddaughter do that, but I always cut the ends off the roast before cooking it because a full roast wouldn't fit in my pan. Now, that's the folly of we've always done it that way. It may have made sense once upon a time, but it doesn't anymore. And creative people know that it's folly. So they forge ahead regardless of what the keepers of this sacrosanct status quo have to say, regardless of the way it's usually done. Resource constraints as an obstacle, inertia, or we've always done it this way as an obstacle. And then there's perhaps the biggest obstacle of all. And a lot of students I've known, both here at Messiah and elsewhere, fall prey to it. For many of us in this room, the most intimidating obstacle to innovating is self-doubt. And as a result, self-censorship. We think, who am I to build something? You know, who am I to do something differently? I'm just some 20-year-old kid. What do I know? And if it were really a good idea, this idea that I have, somebody else would have already run with it. So I'm just going to do my job. I'm just going to do what I'm told, do what everybody else does. This innovation stuff, it's kind of interesting, maybe even really intriguing, but hey, that's for brilliant people. That's not for me. Let me tell you, if you think like that, even just a little bit, I'd say that you're selling yourself short. Most of the stuff you see around you every day was created by people who are no smarter than you are. Self-doubt is really a bad philosophy. And more importantly, it's also bad theology. One of my favorite systematic theologians, a guy named Wayne Grudem from Phoenix Seminary out in Arizona. I got an amen on that one, huh? How about that? Wayne Grudem. And Professor Grudem says it well when he writes this. He says, the imitation of God glorifies God. The imitation of God glorifies God. When we imitate what we see God doing, it pleases him. Now, on that premise, the imitation of God glorifies God, consider this. What's the very first thing we see God doing in the Bible? You know where this is going, don't you? What are the first five words of the book of Genesis? In the beginning, God created. He made something new. There was nothing, and then there is something. He invented it. He innovated intentionally. It's not like he just blew something up accidentally in his lab and, hey, what do you know? A popsicle. Hey, what do you know? Potato chips. What do you know? A universe. Hey, Jesus, come check this out. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that's not the way it happened. In fact, Genesis describes God here as an intentional innovator. We see it in the very first verse of the very first chapter of the very first book of the Bible. So if I have my hermeneutics right, as imitators of God, we too are called to create. Every one of us. You thought you were created and called for community, right? Well, you are, I should say that, lest I be heretical. However, there's more to it. You're also created and called for creating. You ever consider that? Let me tell you, when we create things with right motives, when we do it for God and his kingdom rather than for our glory or for our reputation or for just for our financial gain, great things can happen. Johann Sebastian Bach, the famous composer, used to write on the bottom of his musical compositions, SDG. SDG, it stands for Soli Deo Gloria. It's Latin for to the glory of God alone. Bach was an intentional innovator with right motives. Well, what about you? Did you ever think that you're made for something more than some desk job where you take a pile of papers from the left side of you to the right side of you over 8 hours and you call that a work day and you call that a life? You were made for something more. You're called to create, called to do things that make a difference. Don't settle for good enough as a standard. I'm here tonight to tell you that good enough is not good enough. You're called to create. You're called to imitate God. Maybe in partnership with Him. Maybe with His help. You can do it better than it's ever been done before. And don't accept, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. You've heard that? If it ain't broke, don't fix it. We say that all the time. Just leave it be. It's okay as is. I'm here tonight to tell you, if it ain't broke, then break it. You're called to create. You're called to imitate God. You're called to do it better than it was done before. And maybe in partnership with Him, you can. Don't succumb to self-doubt. You have great new ideas in you, or at least the seeds of them, and you always will, because God places them there. Well, I'm just about out of time, so let me close with this. There's a memorable line in one of the Steve Jobs movies where Jobs is confronting a stubborn Apple manager who has a lethargic work team, a very unmotivated work team that's going nowhere. And the manager is taken aback by Jobs' intervention there and says, "Steve, we're fine. We don't need your help. We're doing fine." And Jobs gets in his face and he says, "Listen, we don't do fine. We don't accept things the way they are, and we never stop innovating." Now, I don't know what Jobs' worldview was, but I do know that as Christians, that's a point that we can certainly embrace. Think about it. We Christians don't do fine. We Christians don't accept things the way they are, and we never stop innovating. We never stop making the world a better place. In the name of Jesus Christ.